been here before for one of our programs. Welcome back. If it's your first time, welcome. I'd like to thank the Friends of the Troy Public Library for helping us have our wonderful programs. If it's your first time here, just a little FYI, the restroom is out this door to your left. And there's also a drinking fountain there if you need that. Tonight we have Joanne Puffer Kotcher, who served in the Red Cross in Korea for 14 months and in Vietnam for 12 months during the war. She had 3 duty stations in Korea and 5 in Vietnam. She was born in Harbor Beach, Michigan, and Kotcher graduated from the University of Michigan with a degree in mathematics. She later went on to earn an MBA. Kotcher never thought she would be part of history, but after a year of teaching boredom, she joined the Red Cross and was sent to Vietnam. The Donut Dollies were unarmed civilians. In Vietnam, Kotcher defied convention by volunteering for combat and combat support duty. Unarmed as a non-combatant, she found herself caught in the bombardment of foxholes and bunkers, serving special forces teams in the Viet Cong jungle, nose to nose with the enemy. Kotcher was one of the first women allowed in a war zone. She was once abducted and was almost killed at least 6 times. Kotcher is one of a few Donut Dollies to receive the Medal of Civilian Service in Vietnam. After a year in Korea and a year's tour in Vietnam, she returned home to face insults of anti-war protesters. Kotcher's book, Donut Dolly, published by the University of North Texas Press in 2011, is based on the diary she kept in Vietnam. It was an 8-year effort of love and duty. The university released Donut Dolly in paperback in October of 2017. Donut Dolly is a University Press bestseller with 35 accolades. The Daughters of the American Revolution have given Donut Dolly their National Award for Women in American History. The newest honor is from the Pentagon. And just so you know, our copy of the book hasn't arrived that we ordered yet, but we are able to order it to be sent from another library in the meantime. It shouldn't be very long. I was checked before we had this program tonight. And with that, you probably want to hear from the Donut Dolly herself.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a privilege to be here for Women's History Month. Each day in Vietnam was its own chapter, filled with sorrow, life, death, and heroism. The true story of the Vietnam War and those who served in it will never be completely known. My book is a historic fragment of what it is to be a warrior. It's not politically correct. It is historically correct.
In this sturdy old part of the city, where the sun refused to shine, people tell me there ain't no use in trying. Now, my girl, you're so young and pretty, and one thing I know is true, you'll be dead before your time is due. I know. Watch my dad.
Watch his hair been a turning gray.
leave me, baby. I know it, baby. You know it too.
That was the all-time favorite song by a mile of all of the people who served in Vietnam. It wasn't written about Vietnam, but the sentiment was what they all appreciated. The history of women in war is not well known, but this is Women's History Month. My family shares the traditions of valor of the people who served this country. I come from a long line of patriots. When you have a name like Puffer, it's easy to trace your roots. Two of my ancestors, the wife and eldest son of Matthias Puffer, were killed by Indians while out picking berries, and several of his best cattle, probably just as valuable. They were the first victims in King Philip's War at Mendon, Massachusetts in 1675, more than 100 years before we became a country. Does anyone know what King Philip's War was about? People from Massachusetts know about it, but we don't hear much about it here. King Philip was a powerful Indian chief. He and all the Indians were tired of the colonists. They came in, took whatever they wanted, as if it didn't belong to anybody, and generally made life miserable for the Indians. They all got together under King Philip and decided to get rid of the white men. Their solution was to kill them all. It seems barbaric to kill women and children like that. Why do you think they did it? What? Well, that wasn't specifically why. It's because if you're going to kill them all, you got to kill the women and children. Otherwise, they'll come back. So it wasn't barbaric. It was practical. And women were valuable to the colonists and to everybody else. I have a picture of King Philip. This is what he looked like. These are the Indians that were allied with him. And these were the New England people, and they were allied with these two Indian tribes. And you'll notice here the strength of the two sides is almost equal. 3,400 for the Indians, 3,500 for the colonists. And look at the casualties. 3,000 for the Indians and 1,000 for the colonists. Long story short, a lot of colonists were killed, but the colonists won. They had guns and firepower that the Indians couldn't match. Still, for a long time, Indians continued to attack the settlements whenever they could. After the raids, the colonists kept records of who was killed, and they also had records of who was missing. Most of those never came back. A few did come back, sometimes many years later. There was one account of a young girl who was captured with her mother and older sister. Her mother told her never to forget her English language. That is why we have her story. Her mother and sister were killed, but she was not. Why? She was very young, so she could be incorporated into the tribe as a member, which they sought because she was a girl. They wanted her specifically because she was a girl. When she grew up, she was given to a warrior as a wife, And I imagine it was an honor for him to have her. How do you think he treated her? He treated her very well, lovingly. He was always very kind to her. And I believe they had some children. She was valuable, and he considered her valuable. I can't remember how the story came out, or how she got away, or whatever, what happened. I was so struck by the fact that she was treated so well. She was made a full member of the tribe. There's another story about a boy who was captured. He was not killed because he was too young to be a soldier. When he grew old enough to be initiated as a man, they gave him a gift. It was a book that he had treasured and had with him when he was captured. They knew how much he treasured it, and they had kept and cared for it until he was a man. They made him part of their family, as a loving part of their family. Following that, we had the War of 1812. The first thing that happened in the War of 1812, the British were still smarting from the Revolutionary War. And they could see that America didn't have their feet under them yet. And so they thought it was a good time to try to take it back. Take their colony back. They first landed at Washington, D.C. And when the people in Washington, the brave people in Washington, heard that the British were coming again, they all left town, including the army. There was nobody to defend Washington, D.C., so the British just walked in and took over. They ate everything that there was to eat, and they burned the White House. And then after 3 days, they left and started going somewhere else. But remember what Dolly Madison did? She saved the portrait of George Washington. And she knew that the British would have a good time with that portrait. So and he was an icon at the time. So instead of saving her personal effects, she saved that. So we still have it now because of that. And then after the war, when the Americans came back in, they tried to rebuild, and they couldn't get the black off the White House. So what they did was they painted it white. That's why we have the White House. Cool? Okay, so after the British left Washington, D.C., they went up to the Lake Country because up there was a lot of commerce. And remember, what was the forte of the British in their military? Navy. They were maritime people, and they wanted those lakes and that trade on those lakes. So they headed up to the east, up upper New York State, to the up there. And the man who led that was General, well, at the time a colonel, Alexander Macomb, for whom our Eastern County is named, because he turned into a wonderful hero. Because what he did, he led the group. They called it the Battle of Plattsburgh, if you want to look it up. And here are the statistics. United States versus the United Kingdom. And Alexander Macomb was one of the commanders. And look at the strength of the two sides. We had 1,500 regulars and 1,900 militia. Does everybody know what militia is? Farmers with guns. And the British had 5,000 regulars. And they had some warships, and we had some fishing boats. And look at the one-sided statistics of how many, the British had 168 killed and 317 captured. The story is so good, I have to tell you. What Macomb did, he was an engineer, and he knew how to build roads. That's what engineers do in the Army, roads and forts. And he had the local farmers with their guns, and they all knew the hills and mountains, and they all knew the area. So what he did was he started building roads. The British didn't know where they were. They didn't know the area. He would build a road that would go nowhere. And then he would build another road that would turn back on itself. Well, if you've got a long column of thousands of troops walking down the road and they suddenly run into themselves, they get all tangled up and you don't even know what you can do with that. So that he and he would put barricades across the roads, and they would spend their time breaking it down, and then they would get down the road and it would be a dead end. So he had them tangled up in their shorts. and so that's why he won all that lake area up in New York and on the Great Lakes. That's what made him such a hero. Well, the next place that was left, well, see, we've got Washington, D.C., we've got the lakes. The only place left is New Orleans. This is where the British are going to go next, to New Orleans. Remember this story? 1814, we took a little trip, along with Colonel Jackson, down the mighty Mississippi. Remember that? Uh-huh. He's the one who said, don't fire till you see the whites of their eyes. And here he is at the Battle of New Orleans. The trouble was, he got down there with 4,500 troops. And the British had 15,000 troops. So he knew what the odds were. He got there ahead of the British, and he told the people in New Orleans, he said, I don't have enough troops to protect this city. You gotta help me. And unlike the heroes of Washington, D.C., the people in New Orleans didn't rabbit out of there. They collected their guns, they built barricades, they got ready, and they stood there and stood their ground to protect their city. And one of the things that was different about New Orleans, and why I'm telling the story, is because some of those people on those barricades were women. And with the small numbers that they had, I like to think that even though the women was a small number, they might have made the difference in that battle. I'm sure they did. You're all sure they did, right? They all did. It's settled, they did. They made the difference. So look at the totals here. Americans had 333 killed, and the British had 2,000 459, 2,500 killed, wounded, or captured. It was a one-sided battle. They really ripped them. That was the mighty British. And they ran back on their ships and went home, and they've been our friends ever since. Happy ending. Oh, the big deal about New Orleans. Whoever held New Orleans, come on, would get, all right. Oh, maybe it's down here. There it is. No? Would get the Louisiana Purchase. The Louisiana Purchase goes from, okay, here we go. Did you remember that's how big the Louisiana Purchase was? All the way up into Canada. Can you see it? That's what was at stake at New Orleans. And that doubled the size, more than doubled the size of our country when we bought that. Because of women. Women's history. Okay, next we come to the Civil War. What did women do in the Civil War? I think a lot of people know that when the men were all away fighting, the women were at home and they had to handle everything. But they also knew that supplies were scarce. So they would get together and they would load a wagon with all the neighbors, anything that the neighbors could spare to give to the soldiers. Maybe some canned goods, maybe some quilts. And one of the women, maybe a grandmother, would drive the wagon, and maybe a young unmarried woman whose work they could spare, she would go along. They would risk their lives to go as close as they could to the fighting to deliver the supplies. And then the wounded would be loaded onto the wagon to go home to be cared for at home. And the young unmarried woman would stay and help in the hospital. And these are some of the things that the women did in the Civil War. But there was something else that the women did in the Civil War. They dressed up as men and went with the men to fight. And the men did not know that they were women. Up until recently, it's been thought that there weren't very many of them. But there's been more research, and they're finding that there were a lot of them. Here are some of them. Here are some more. They are finding that there may have been anywhere between 400 and 750 women disguised as men, fighting alongside the men, that the men did not know they were women. Here's some more of them. Well, there's a whole bunch more. Here are some more. And some more, and some more. I can't believe how many there were. Look at that. And nobody knew they were women. Some of them were found out, especially since, for example, one of them would be wounded, and they would rip their clothes off to try to take care of the wound and discover that they had a woman. What did they do with them? If they found out they were women, sent them home. However, some of them were put in jail. It wasn't supposed to be. That was a real surprise when things like that happened. We honor the bravery of those men and women who fought to create and defend our great country. But nothing is static. Our nation has had to prove we could defend our interests many times during our turbulent history. Vietnam was one of those times. I returned home after 12 months in Vietnam, no longer an idealistic 20-year-old. Oh, let me put this back on. I had become a cautious realist. I recall carefully folding my light blue uniform and storing it on a closet shelf in my new apartment in Flint. It had served me well, perspiration stains and all. A year's worth of friendships, fear, dangers, successes, failures, and a dab of a love story now was relegated to a closet. Outside, I could see young people. They weren't doing anything remarkable. They swam in the pool, washed their cars, talked to each other, arranged dates, everyday activities. This had all become foreign to me. I was a stranger in my own homeland. I was no longer a participant, but I felt a pride that I had helped protect their way of life. I was a donut dolly, a proud member of a division of the American Red Cross. We were required to be single and a college graduate. We belonged to a tradition that began in World War I. Its purpose was to inspire the soldiers by reminding them of the people they left back home, their mothers and sisters, nieces and cousins, their girlfriends, or maybe that cute girl next door they never had the courage to talk to. We were close to the men. We were a letter from home. One veteran told me everybody was in love with a donut dolly. The Red Cross warned us in training. The soldiers wouldn't love us. They loved the recollections of their home, their family, their country, and those things we represented. That's what they saw when they saw me. One veteran told me, "When we saw you, we left Vietnam for a few minutes and we were home." When I arrived in Vietnam as a donut dolly, I was a recreation supervisor. I had 14 months of experience with the Red Cross in Korea. Soon after my arrival in Vietnam, I almost joined my patriotic ancestors. On Thanksgiving in 1966, when everybody was getting ready to turn in, a few officers were standing near a bunker. One had acquired a bottle of cheap champagne. They offered me a taste in a small paper cup. I think it was a specimen cup from the hospital. As the officer poured my portion, we heard three sniper shots. Crack, crack, crack. Bullets exploded a few inches from my head. Everyone dropped to the ground. A sniper had targeted my light blue uniform with me in it. The Red Cross might as well have painted a bullseye on my back. Viet Cong wanted to kill a donut dolly. It would be debilitating to the military's morale. This time they missed. Thank you, Lord, for people who can't shoot straight. Why the name Donut Dolly? In World War I, two Salvation Army ladies gave out some donuts to soldiers in France. In World War II, young American Red Cross women passed out donuts and coffee to our troops in rest areas in England. The men called them donut dollies. The name stuck through Korea and then in Vietnam. In Korea, we had recreation programs with games and stories and donuts. In Vietnam, we didn't have donuts. In the words of one mess sergeant, it was too damn hot to make them. I served first in Korea for 14 months, then 12 months in Vietnam during some of the early ferocious days of the war, 1966-67. Some of the time we could give recreation programs. More often, combat vehicles took us to the frontline foxholes where we could visit with our soldiers. We went wherever commanders requested. That was our job, 7 days a week. We have a map. The publisher told me that I had to have a map with any place mentioned in the book had to be on the map. So this is what I got. I traveled from the Central Highlands, which are right here, to the Mekong Delta, which is here, from the South China Sea to the Cambodian border. I saw pretty much most of the country. This jacket tells stories of heroism. These are the units that I visited, and these were given to me as a gift. These soldiers had nothing to give, but they wanted to do something. So I have about 36. Most of the time, I didn't know where I was, but this tells me where I was. Oh, incidentally, the light blue uniform that I was putting away at the beginning of this speech. This is it. It has shrunk a little. When I wrote the book, Donut Dolly, I wanted others to feel and understand what it was like to be there, to be a witness to that war. I wrote what I saw and what I did. The book is a time capsule reflected in the diary I kept. Bravery and honor. Those are just two of the virtues that in one way or another, all our veterans share. When we all first arrived in Vietnam, we were scared, but we learned to manage our fear. Did you notice that in the helicopter? So the new guys were scared, and the guys who'd been there a while, it was like, yeah, I don't like it here, but I'm okay for right now. We earned the right to understand the meaning of courage. It was the foundation of the bravery we found in ourselves. It gave us the confidence to represent the best of those who have served and earned the right to the title of veteran. We've drawn on that strength throughout our lives. This pride is one of the unspoken and priceless benefits of our service. There were 600 donut dollies in Vietnam over the 10 years of the war. The program ended in 1972. As our military slowly left, the country became too dangerous. This is like one of the activities we would take with us to go to when we saw the soldiers. Pick a card. Pick that one. Thank you. Oh my goodness, the 9th Cavalry Party. That was a really good party. You picked a good story. It is page 93. Thursday, July 28, an officer from the 1st and the 9th Cavalry, Air Reconnaissance, telephoned. We're celebrating our 100th anniversary. We want to invite the Red Cross girls and the nurses. This was the 1st Cavalry Division. Oh, not wearing it today. It's on the coat. It's on the coat. When there was a big party, they would invite all the Red Cross girls, all four of us, and all the nurses, all eight of them. That was the party. The men usually invited the women when they had a party. It will start in 3 hours. I'm sorry we didn't find out about it until a day and a half ago. We usually had more than 3 hours to get ready for a party. But for a 100th anniversary, we could do it. On time. A tall captain wearing an old-fashioned black cavalry hat with a gold band stood in the door of our tent to escort us. I thought, wow, does he look sharp? A cavalry hat right out of history. It was actually General Custer's actual unit. The captain drove the bouncing Jeep with all four of us clinging to it. We threw everything together. Nobody knew it was our 100th anniversary until we got a note from our counterpart, the Vietnamese 9th Cavalry, to congratulate us. I thought, they'd been busy fighting the war. We went scrambling to our records, and sure enough, it's our 100th anniversary. We started to work on it on the double. We pulled all the men in from the field, set up a banquet, and a day and a half later, here we are. We appreciate you girls coming on such short notice. The evening had begun with the banquet of wine and steak. We arrived late, so by the time we ate, the party was well underway. Our dinner completed, all the Red Cross girls left the table for the ballroom. As I walked through the double doors, a captain put his arm around me. Would you like a drink? Military and Red Cross protocol dictated that nobody touched us. Putting an arm around us was unheard of. It annoyed me, but these men had been in the jungle and could be excused some things. I smiled, ignored the question, and walked on. People were singing, accompanied by a guitar. And then a band arrived. Dancing was fast and energetic. The party got louder. By now, it was on the verge of a fight. The 9th Cavalry was known for its bad behavior. I figured that's what you have to be for reconnaissance. I was having a good time, except for the groping captain. Every time I got near him, he put his arm around me, frustrating my attempt to stay away from him. He was the burdock seeds that used to cling to my socks when I was a kid. I went outside where it was warm and humid and was talking to a group of people when someone came up behind me, put his arm around my waist, and pulled me away to another group. I thought, keep your hands off me. It was the captain, drunk by now. I want you to meet some people. I let him introduce me to three or four officers and then excused myself. I was gone about a minute when that arm went around me again. He knew when it came to the Red Cross girls, the rule was don't touch. I became angry. I took a judo position. I had studied judo in Korea and gave a short yell, yeah, get away. I hoped he would get the hint. All officers had learned judo in basic training. He understood, but he didn't believe me. I calculated. He's tall, so I'll have to use a leg throw, even if it's easier to defend against. He's strong. I took him by the collar and sleeve. Are you ready? I'm going to throw you. He said, okay, I'm ready. I think he's enjoying this. Not for long. I rehearsed the move as I executed it. I didn't want to hurt him. I pulled him toward me, stepped behind, and kicked his legs out from under him. He didn't defend against me. I pulled up on his arm to keep him from landing on his face and let go. I should not have let him go. I should have continued to pull up on his arm to make sure he landed on his back so he wouldn't be hurt. But I was angry. He flew into the air, bounced off two people, then fell off a wall. I saw him lying on his back, stretched out on the ground. Two dozen people stood there, drinks in their hands, staring at him. Our escort instantly appeared. He picked up my watch and handed it to me, ordering me to come this way. He steered me through the crowd to the Jeep and steadied me while I climbed in. I was wobbly because one of my shoe heels had broken off. Another officer guided the other girls. The Jeep headed for home. Our escort said guardedly, did you see the green tabs on his epaulets? My eyes fell on our escort's shoulder, a green tab. He's a combat leader. I thought, he could have killed me. He must have been humiliated to have you throw him like that. In front of all those officers, some reported directly to him. I admired his restraint. He had a great deal of self-control to let me do that. It was true that the military trained men to be officers and gentlemen even when they were drunk. Our escort laughed. That was a good party. The only fight we had was yours. General William Westmoreland, commander of military assistance, invited the Donut Dollies to serve alongside his soldiers in Vietnam. We didn't know it, but that was the first time women were allowed in a combat zone. We know they were there, but they weren't allowed. The Donut Dollies went in right after the first landing of Marines. My Red Cross number was 45. I was the 45th Donut Dolly to arrive in Vietnam, and one of the first to go into the battle zone. Later, other women pointed to us and asked, if the Donut Dollies can do it, why can't we? Women in the combat zone was bold in 1966. Today, women have the right to work in most military specialties, and as a consequence, civilian women have made parallel progress. Imagine, General Westmoreland, a military man, is responsible for spearheading women's rights and opportunities for advancement. Donut Dollies were not nurses. Officially, we were recreation for able-bodied troops, those not in hospitals, though we did visit hospitals whenever we could. Our purpose was to raise morale, to help the soldiers remember home. Our duty was to work with combat and combat support troops in isolated areas. Unarmed, without any type of weapon, our assignment was to give our young soldiers a break from the war for a few minutes. They showed their gratitude everywhere we went. That assignment was often more dangerous than most people would expect. I was inches from being killed half a dozen times. I had to be prepared for a bullet whizzing past me, a mortar shell to land a short distance away, or being surrounded by Viet Cong. With 600 Donut Dollies over the 10 years of the war, there might have been 60 of us in the whole country at any one time. We covered an area about the size of the Lower Peninsula of Michigan. We were a rare sight. In 1966, the Army nurses had to stay in the rear areas. Other military women, the WACs, weren't allowed to be in Vietnam until late in my tour. As far as I know, the World War II waves, the Navy women, had never gone past Hawaii. The gift of my war experience from our military is why I had to write the only book that chronicles the life of one of the first women allowed in a combat zone. People ask, was I scared? Well, yes, until I got used to my surroundings. The enemy was all around us. Artillery fired day and night. Bugs crawled everywhere. The day shift of insects, like loyal workers, were always on time, nibbling on any exposed body parts. Sirens woke us at night. We had to grab our combat gear and run to a bunker. We sat there for hours, slapping malaria mosquitoes, waiting for a shell to land on us and kill us. One night on K, when all four of us were new, the siren screamed shortly after dark. We weren't in our tent where we could grab our combat gear. We just ran from wherever we were and dove into our bunker. The eight nurses from the hospital dove in behind us, and some random soldiers who happened to be nearby. I lay on the floor where I fell inside the bunker. It was pitch black. I couldn't see my hand in front of my face. Not even when my eyes got used to the dark, nothing. No one dared to move. You couldn't see where anyone was or who anyone was, male or female. If you moved an inch, you felt a body. From comments in the dark, from disembodied voices, I calculated there were 15 people in that 8-foot by 10-foot bunker. 8 nurses, 4 donut dollies, the chaplain, who was a captain, a lieutenant, and a major. I noticed that the only person in the bunker who was armed was the chaplain. It was Sunday, he was working. I learned recently that in 1977, chaplains are now not allowed to be armed. They have an assistant who is armed and goes with them. But I don't think that's enough. Also, when they're in a Humvee, there's an extra weapon. I can't see, with the enemies we're fighting, why we have such restrictions. In the bunker at Onkay, the mortars crashed around us. Then our own artillery, the big guns, began answering. We dollies jumped and froze with fear with every explosion. The lieutenant laughed. He said, "You know what they say, don't worry, you never hear the one that gets you." Recently, a couple weeks ago, when I read that line, there was a veteran sitting right there. He finished the sentence with me. That didn't help. The major was more sympathetic. He told us, "Listen, if you hear a boom, you will hear a swish." We listened. We heard boom, swish. He said, "If you hear the boom first, then the swish, it's ours going out. The gun fires. The swish is the shell flying overhead. And the other boom, when the shell lands, is so far away you won't hear it." I learned later, while writing Donut Dolly, that guns are never allowed to fire over people, because a short round could always land anywhere under the path of the shell. That precaution was out the window, evidently. In the blacked-out bunker, the major told us, "If you hear the swish first, then the boom, it's an enemy mortar coming in." In my mind, I finished the thought. That's the one that might get you. We relaxed a little, listening to the boom swish. Then we heard it, swish, but no boom. Everyone froze. It sounded like it was right on top of us. We held our breath and waited for the explosion. Where? And we waited and waited. It never came. Slowly, we relaxed a little, but not quite fully. We went back to talking quietly and listening, but we never really relaxed. No one dared ask what happened to that last boom. After a couple of hours, a runner came and announced the all clear. We went back to our tent and never spoke of it again. After a few weeks in Vietnam, I learned where the real dangers were and where it was safe, sort of like the guys in the helicopter. Some of them knew that they were okay where they were. I relaxed and could go about my work normally, as we did in the bunker. Then a few weeks later, I learned that some places we thought were safe really weren't. We didn't know we were in danger until days or weeks or even years, as with the rule about being under a flying artillery shell. Well, by then it was too late to be scared. Donut Dolly will forever be the only professionally published, peer-reviewed book about the Vietnam War. Do you know what peer-reviewed is? The book has to be reviewed by experts in your field to make sure that it's correct. And this is a peer-reviewed book. This will be the only one written by a woman. Of the 600 dollies who served, barely 100 remain. I'm the only one in Michigan. Donut Dolly, an American Red Cross girl's war in Vietnam. The hardcover was sold out, and it was selling so well that they brought it out in paperback. And now the hardcover is a collectible. Cool. This book was conceived in the diary that I kept in Vietnam. The final draft was published in 2011. I dedicated 8 years researching and writing the book. If it were a child, it would be 8 years old and in the third grade. Weeks of research and personal contacts led to hundreds of old, new friends. Veterans talked to me when they would not talk to anyone else. They still think of me as a donut dolly, one of them. One soldier who learned we'd both been at Landing Zone Betty at Fantiette told me we both trod the same dirt. The University of North Texas, my publisher, was as demanding and vicious as a colleague I had taught with in Flint, Sister Mary Godzilla. But the university would back the book. I couldn't be mostly right. Last October, the Daughters of the American Revolution honored Donut Dolly with their National Award for Women in American History. The American Library Association has recommended Donut Dolly for public and school libraries. Some of you may want to donate some signed copies to your schools, kind of bring them into the 20th century, your libraries and museums. You may know someone who would enjoy a gift of Donut Dolly. My diary and the book cover 1 year, a year that seemed endless. My book is a time capsule of both heroism and history. It's a university bestseller. It has received 35 national and international literary awards. The newest one is from the Pentagon. And now it's out in paperback. Commanders asked Donut Dollies to take risks. Our visits meant so much. We dove into bunkers alongside the soldiers. We were unarmed, fellow warriors, dressed in sky blue. And I was almost killed at least 6 times. The soldiers with the most need were the ones in the most danger. I was a civilian, not allowed to carry a weapon. But our brothers accepted me as one of them. A veteran once told me, seeing a Donut Dolly after 10 or 11 months in the field was like seeing an angel walking. Why is the book important? Because it chronicles the everyday Vietnam soldier from the woman's point of view. We saw them in their unguarded moments. These are the soldiers who were humiliated in their own country. Some people said then, as they do today, they hated the war but loved the soldiers. That's a lie. They hated the soldiers. Otherwise, why did they spit on them? Other veterans, I had a note from a woman recently. She asked me to send a book to a relative in Arizona. She said he served in Vietnam, and when his tour was over, he traveled from San Francisco to Chicago to meet his wife. Can you get my pictures to show, please? When he met his wife, he had been so abused on that trip that he took his uniform off and threw it in the trash. And other veterans have told me that a lot of them did that. The veterans are so often portrayed as dope addicts and warmongers. They're your neighbor's kid, the husband of the woman down the street. They are us. In wartime, the man who lives up the hill faced dangers with a constant courage. Our soldiers knew they had a job to do, and they did their job with honor and bravery. They faced a war that was hell, as if it were an everyday occurrence, because it was.
Yay!
Yay! Thank you very much. This is when I first got the jacket in Korea. And we took some donuts to the field, and the men were really thrilled. Korea, the program was over 10 years old, so it was very settled. We had a lot of people. That's me on this end. I was a blonde then. My first day in Vietnam, the field director, the Red Cross field director, he was not part of our unit, but he was assigned to the hospital, and he kind of kept an eye on us. And he took me on a tour of the village. So this is our lovely village of An Khe. These are the ladies of An Khe, and you'll notice they're barefoot. The debris in the street is an open sewer, and they are walking in it. Yeah. Here's the school. How many school teachers we have here?
One.
This school has five rows. The bench is one long board. The desk is one long board. There are 10 children in each row. And the first two rows are girls, and the last two rows are boys. And as you can see, the traffic is going by their elbow. There is no wall on there. They come in through the street. This is the kind of thing that makes a teacher have nightmares. This is the gun that was on the bridge that spanned the river that was between the village and the base. And as I was emailing people back and forth, they told me that shortly after I left on K, the VC blew that bridge up. So having a gun on it didn't protect it. This is the interior of the recreation center at Onkay, and I sat and watched a card game. We moved around and tried to do what we could to help the soldiers. Our tent was right next to the hospital, and I shot this from the door of our tent. This is the ambulance taking a patient. This is the second place I went. It was 1st Infantry Division, and these guys were all looking at the corner here. They had a television in this tent, which you could see is a sieve when it rains. Well, this is me. We're visiting an artillery unit. And I had a chance to talk to the guns, and they were very flabbergasted to hear an American girl talking to them on the phone. This man is using a slide rule. That's how they would figure out how to aim the guns. Anybody here use a slide rule ever? There you go. A few of you, long time ago. I thought it was a really cool instrument. This is a trip. Whenever we went someplace, they treated us like queens. Where's my pilot here? There. He said he took a lot of donut dollies around. And they treated us like movie stars. This is, as you can see, the Champagne flight. And we're going to the Delta now. Now we're going to Bearcat. This is the first part of December. 66. And people say that's a good picture, and I tell them if you took 1,000 pictures, one of them's going to be good. We were going they were building this area for new troops coming in. They bulldozed the whole thing, chased away the tigers and the tarantulas, and these men are building showers and latrines. And we drove around, and we had board a game where they would mark on these boards, and I think it was something like a trivia quiz where you would race to see which team could win. Just any little game just to make a vehicle for interaction. We had a recreation center. Now we're at Benoit. As you can see, these guys are airborne, and they're a little bit more aggressive than most of the guys. It's interesting, the different occupations really have different attitudes. They, as I said, the 9th Cavalry was a bad behavior. And the airborne were more aggressive than others. They would walk in and do stuff when other people wouldn't be that eager to go and try something. And we served coffee. We had a coffee call Sunday morning. And we didn't just put the coffee out. We served everybody, and we spoke to everybody. And that was the point of the coffee. It was a vehicle to interact with the soldiers. And this is our big, huge recreation center. This girl's in civilian clothes. We had a half-day off every other week. when we wore civilian clothes, but the guys loved to see us in civilian clothes, and on our day off, we would go to that coffee. Why are these out of focus? Well, don't know. Well, this is me doing a game out in the woods. Here we are visiting the top of a mountain. You can see we're above the clouds, and you can also see the helicopter has not shut down. It's not safe for us to be there, very safe. And if you shut the helicopter down, it takes a while for it to heat up, warm up before you can fly it. So they had to stay running. These are porters bringing supplies up the side. This is Nui Ba Din. If some of you guys knew what Nui Ba Din was, it's a radio relay station. And we owned the top, the VC owned the sides and bottom, but the VC allowed the porters to go up and down. The VC could have just attacked and wiped out the whole station anytime they wanted to, but they didn't, because if they did that, we would just send a couple of jets and blast them back off again. So it was a standoff. And these guys came in off a night ambush, and we served breakfast for them. Then that was a big surprise. I don't know why. And you recognize this man?
James Garner.
Yes. I have been in love with James Garner all this time. And that's me. We shared a helicopter all day long, stopping here and there and here and there. And he was wonderful with the troops. He served in Korea. He had a Purple Heart. I looked him up. He was really wonderful. Oh, dear. This is the Delta. You can see the three-corner hat. It indicates that they were they're the oldest continuously serving unit in the Army. It dates back to Washington. They were in the Delta. And these are prisoners of war. I was privileged to get a chance to see some. And they're...
The people in the back.
All these people are prisoners of war. They were loose on the compound. All they did was threaten to send them back home if they tried to get away. So nobody wanted to go back home. So... there's one more story that I have time for. I was 10 days from going home. It looked like I would make it in one piece, though it had started to feel like my luck was running out. In a helicopter, two of us girls, Camilla from Atlanta, she's the one in the picture, and I, with an escort officer and crew, hopped from one Special Forces camp to another, deep in Viet Cong territory. Night was falling. The Viet Cong owned the night. A tropical storm was closing in. To fly a helicopter through a storm would be suicidal. Our chopper spiraled down and landed. We waited. The storm got worse. The weather report said it surrounded us. We had a choice: stay on the ground overnight and be attacked by the VC for sure, or try to fly out and be torn apart by the storm, or worse, be struck by lightning and crash and burn. Everyone looked at me to make the decision. I didn't know why. I was 107 pounds of sweating blonde. It was because I was a civilian. I outrank every military person. I didn't know that. I was thrust into command to give a life or death order to men with M60 machine guns with bullets as long as a number two pencil. I had no time to think. I said, "Let's go," taking my chances with God. The co-pilot, crew chief, and gunner stood up. Our escort officer, Captain Goodwin, frowned. And he's the one in the picture. A jeep brought us to the helicopter. The night hung black and blood warm. Tropical air folded heavily around us. The rain had stopped. I climbed into the helicopter and fumbled for a seatbelt. This was the only time I ever wore a seatbelt in a helicopter. "Lighten the aircraft," someone said. Everybody passed boxes out. The pilots strapped in. Suddenly, a blinding flash of lightning exploded in the sky. The world had caught fire. The pilot looked at, co-pilot looked at the pilot and said, "Oh," he hesitated. The pilot didn't falter. "Don't sweat it." He checked his instruments. I changed my definition of bravery. The old one was, "You're brave if you're scared, but you do it anyway." Now I added, "And you don't let anyone know it." I tried to follow the pilot's advice. "Don't sweat it." The helicopter blade labored into action. The gunner and crew chief climbed in behind their machine guns. I heard clicks and the scrape of metal on metal as they readied their weapons. The ship shuddered and lifted off the ground. Fear seized me. Was I losing the battle? The pilot didn't turn on the landing lights. The ship's tail lifted in the moonless, storm-black night. We began to rise and spiral into the air. My ears popped. Gravity pulled at us. The ship spirals to stay over the camp. If you take off low, the VC will shoot you down. Rain exploded on the windshield. Inside the ship, everything was dark, except for the green glow of the instrument lights. The windshield wipers began to lose their struggle to keep up with the rain. Without warning, a monstrous flash of lightning streaked across the length and breadth of the sky. Fiery fingers reached for us. I couldn't understand why they didn't touch us. Suddenly, the helicopter jolted to the right. Everything went black. I braced for free fall. The ship shuddered for a few seconds and righted itself and kept flying. The windshield wipers resumed their assigned duties. The instruments glowed green again. We and the ship were still alive. I sat there for a moment in disbelief. The gunner on my side of the helicopter, beside his M60 machine gun, was asleep. Half an hour later, we finally reached our landing point. As if orchestrated, everyone in the chopper exhaled with nervous relief. We were home. God bless our veterans, those who fought in Vietnam 50 years ago, and those who have fought in wars and conflicts before and since. They proved our country's mettle once more. God bless us all, and God bless America. If you have some questions, we have about 10 minutes. Yes?
How would you compare your time in Korea to Vietnam?
Well, Korea, there was no war.
Oh.
The men in Vietnam were more energetic and enthusiastic. The ones in Korea were just terribly homesick and terribly bored. The ones in Vietnam weren't bored. West of Seoul at, that was 50 years ago. Can't remember. There were three places. The 8th Army headquarters was west of Seoul, and then I was north with the 1st Cavalry, and then I was, I can't remember. I can't remember the one other place. Yes?
Have you ever gone back to Vietnam?
No. A lot of guys have said that they have. And of course, the communists have taken over. And the ones who have gone back have said that all the people that they knew, including the children that were there, have disappeared. And the only progress that's been made in the country has been in the cities. The countryside is totally ignored.
When were the Yolo Girls officially, when did they become a group? What year?
That was, I think it was World War II. I'm trying to remember if there were, no, silly. My great aunt was in World War I. She was a nurse with the Red Cross. And I have her diary, which is very, very cool. And she recorded that she went to a dance, a Red Cross recreation dance. So they had Red Cross all over the world in World War I. Yes. Yeah. We served able-bodied. Huh?
Who formed the group?
The Red Cross. Claire Barton, the one who drove the wagon in Civil War, she was the one who started the Red Cross. And they started as nurses. And they did supply a lot of nurses. But the recreation service was separate.
Going to be a dolly.
One of them sent me a cross in the mail. I think my parents were very apprehensive about it. When I got back, everybody was really, my old girlfriends from high school and college were very enthusiastic about seeing me again. I don't know if they thought maybe they weren't going to. But they weren't mean to me or anything. But some of the people were. I put some of that in the book.
Were there any casualties among your group?
Yes. We lost three. And one was wounded and permanently disabled. And those stories are in the book.
Do you correspond with anybody?
I have, yeah, on email. I don't really know any of the other girls because there were so few of us and far between, we never spent any time together. Any time we spent with the men in Vietnam. In Korea, we were with each other a lot because there were 10 of us in that one unit. And there were more of us, and we saw each other more frequently. And I have. And they have reunions every year. One of the things that I haven't gone to any of the reunions because I noticed talking to some of the girls, their attitudes were different from what I remembered, and some of their vocabulary was different because they were the world was changing, and I wanted the book to be a time capsule. I didn't want it to be polluted with new ideas and new information. I wanted all of it to be just exactly the way it was in 66, 67. So you can't believe how hard I had to fight to let them, to get them to let me use the word girl. They wanted me to say that we were women. Well, we weren't. In 1966, we were girls. And if you say women, it's not historically correct. And that's the way it was through the book. I wanted everything to be historically correct. I don't care what politics. It's not entering into it.
Did you have any interaction with the, like you showed one side of Vietnamese women? Was there ever an opportunity? I know it wasn't your mission. Wasn't why you were there, but was there ever any?
Not in Vietnam at all, no. But in Korea, I had had a pen pal in Korea since 10th grade. Oh. And I had a chance to visit her family a couple, three times. Mm-hmm. And I'm still writing to her.
Oh.
So yeah, I had that in Korea, but in fact, I was thinking recently that I never even had a taste of Vietnamese food. It wasn't safe. You couldn't go off the base. So I found there's a Vietnamese restaurant that has a good critique, so I'm going to try to go. I saw a man eating some Vietnamese food once. He had brought it into the mess hall. It looked yucky. It was like greenish, and it looked like a plate full of mud. So I wasn't too interested. But the thing about Vietnamese food is that it's very spicy, very, very hot. So most of us probably couldn't eat it. You'd have to have them tone it down for you.
Did you bring back any mementos from your time there?
I did, yeah. My favorite one was a crossbow. I bought it from the Montagnards on these trips to the Special Forces camps. The Special Forces would trade with the Montagnards, and then I bought the crossbow from them. And then there was a guitar made out of a piece of bamboo that was slit so that the slits remained attached at both ends, and you could pluck it. That was cool. But the problem is, they're so humid compared to our dry air that these things fell apart. So, and I also had another one. It was really good. The mortars will shoot a shell, but they will also shoot an illumination round, which goes up and turns into a ball of fire and lights up everything so that people can see what they're shooting at. And then after a battle, these expended illumination rounds will land around, and you can pick them up, and they look like a little rocket. And I had one, and I kept it for a long time, and I finally said, "Gee, what am I supposed to do with this?" And I finally threw it away. And then, of course, as soon as you throw something away, then you wish you still had it. So.
What was the time gap from the time you were in Korea until you went to Vietnam? Because you were in your 20s in Vietnam, so
yeah.
How did that work out?
Okay, I graduated from college in 63. I got a job teaching school for that 1 year. Then after that 1 year, I went to Korea for 1 year. And then after, when my Korean tour was over, my grandmother came to Korea and met me, and the two of us came home the long way around the world. We spent 3 months doing that. Mm-hmm. Cool?
Yeah.
And then I got a job teaching school for about 6 months, for the rest of that year. And then in the end of that year, I went to Vietnam for a year.
Which was what year?
That would have been 66, and came home in 67. It was May when I signed up.
How long was your training?
For Korea, we had 2 weeks in Washington, D.C., and then seemed to me a weekend or some more days in Korea. And then when I came to go to Vietnam, I was in a class of one. So they gave me a desk and a stack of papers to read, and they gave me a week to read them. And that was my training.
Did you get paid anything to do this?
We got paid the same as a Army private, which was about $90-some a month.
Just about,
okay. Then I learned recently that in Vietnam they got combat pay, which almost doubled their pay. But we didn't get it because we were non-combatants.
You had a crossbow, come on.
I was armed, wasn't I?
Where were you in Vietnam, exactly?
Let's see. I was in the Central Highlands, that was on K, the cavalry. And then I was, what did I say? I went Dong Patin, which is down south and to the coast a little bit. And then I went to Zion, which was inland a little more. And then I was at Benoit, which was not too far from there, was still in that general area.
In Saigon area?
No, we were not supposed to be in Saigon. We were for isolated areas. So our whole idea was to be not in Saigon. Well, you've been a wonderful audience.
Thank you.